Hi there everyone, welcome to Infinity Drones. I focus mainly on drone how-to videos as well as informational content. If there's anything you guys enjoy or have questions about, please feel free to leave a comment below. And if you like the content, please remember to subscribe. Today we're going to take a look at the DJI Pilot app, specifically being used with the Mavic 2 Enterprise Advanced. This is the new thermal drone DJI released recently. It features a 640 by 512 thermal camera and it makes use of the DJI Pilot app. The DJI Pilot app is not the same like the DJI Fly app or the DJI Go 4 app. It's quite different with the layout, the options available, as well as the camera settings and so forth. However, if you do have DJI Go 4 app experience, the jump is not going to be so big. Once you're logged into the application, you are going to be presented with the standard pre-flight checks that you see in the Go 4 app. In this case, you can see there's a compass calibration required. Tapping the button is going to bring up the prompt and you can calibrate. It's very important that you guys understand, if you're going to calibrate, do not do the calibration dance like the guys on YouTube show you. You stand in a stationary position, you pick up the drone, and you pivot it in a single location. You do not turn your body or anything like that, because then you're naturally changing the GPS location, defeating the whole purpose of the calibration. It still works, but it can be more accurate if you keep it in a central place. So just pivot the drone in its current position and then complete the task as described on the screen. Once that's completed, click the top right X, and on the top left you're gonna see a little icon where you can adjust the gimbal rotation. Quite useful feature in the Pilot app, because sometimes you've looked down left and right and you can just recenter it by a tap of the screen. Pretty cool feature to have. One more thing you guys are going to notice is that there's no takeoff button. The only way to take off is to pull the sticks 45 degrees down and out on each stick, or push them in at a 45 degree angle. That is the only way that you can power up the drone and take off. Tapping on the top right is going to open the option menu for you, and this is going to show you all of the configuration. Your default one is for the drone itself, where you can specify the home point, enable dynamic home point, return to home altitude, your maximum altitude, your distance limit, and so forth. If you tap on the actual number icon on the screen, it'll give you an option to change the value there. So if you want to change your distance from 400 meters to, let's say, 8 kilometers or 8,000 meters, just tap it in the little box and update it straight from there. Tapping the center status can give you the IMU status as well as the compass status. They should all be green. Then you can go a bit lower down and change your altitude limits when you've lost GPS signal. But there's a really important one. What happens when RC signal is lost? That should always be set to return to home, unless you are flying inside of a building and you require the drone to just hover while you walk closer and regain signal. If you're flying outside and you lose RC signal, then the drone's just going to hover. And essentially, if you don't have signal, you're going to lose your drone because the battery's going to run out and it's going to auto land. But if you change it to return to home, when you lose signal, the drone is automatically like 5 seconds before it will initiate a return to home, go to a certain altitude and come straight back home. You can also configure how to stop your motors, especially if you're in a breakdown scenario, then you can push the sticks in and out to stop the motors from spinning. This is incredibly important that you guys leave the setting as in, or make sure that it is in the breakdown state. Because if the motors can't spin, you want to have an option to turn it off so they don't burn out. But you don't want to be flying and accidentally push the sticks in a certain way and then turn off the motors. The next option we'll be looking at is the obstacle avoidance tab. Technically, you just want to leave everything on. But let's say there's a scenario where you want to turn off the bottom sensors or the obstacle avoidance sensors, then you can come here and turn it off. You're also able to configure the LED light that goes on, typically called the landing light. And you can select the auto option, on, off, or navigation light mode only. So, pretty useful feature to have. The next option is your controller option. Here you can specify what the C1 and the C2 buttons do just by selecting the option available in the drop-down menu. Remember, pressing the button on the bottom of your controller will initiate whatever you've selected from this drop-down menu. Next, you can specify your 5D button on the front of the controller. Pretty useful if you want to increase your camera settings maybe on the fly. Next, the HD option, where you can view your image transmission and view the signal strength. But the main reason you'll be accessing this section is to change the video output option. Now, if you've got a smart controller, which you've got with the Enterprise Advanced, you have an HDMI output and you can specify what type of image is going to be sent to the HDMI cable. The next option is your battery options. This is where you're able to view if smart return to home is enabled, what your percentage for critical and low battery is in, and also what time is going to be used as a discharge for your batteries. If you tap the details button, you can also view the voltage as well as the number of charges of your batteries. Next option is going to be your gimbal settings, where you can calibrate it, configure the speed that it looks up and down by. And the last option on the menu is going to be your common settings. This is where you can specify your live stream options. You can specify your units that it's going to use with, for instance, metric or imperial. If you want the RMLEC LEDs to be turned on or turned off, you can also set up the live stream options. You can see quite a few settings, IP addresses you can configure straight from there. And essentially, that is what you want. You also have one other option you could see on the screen called ESC beeping at the far bottom. If you've lost your drone, you can try and enable this option and the motors are going to start beeping. And this could assist in trying to find the drone again if need be. At the bottom, you can change the name. You can also take a look at the versions of the software that's available currently and install. Once you're done here, you can just tap the X on top right and you can exit the menu. And on the bottom right, you'll see a little slider bar underneath the shutter button. If you tap that, you can take a look at the camera setting option. Over here, you can see there's not a lot of options you can change. The only thing you can tap is the negative and the plus button to change the exposure value up or down. The Enterprise Advanced does not give you the option to change your camera settings manually. Even switching between infrared mode and visual mode doesn't give you that option. As you can see, I'm looking up now and I can just tap on the plus and the negative on the screen to increase the digital zoom. Naturally, at night that's going to be horrible, but during the course of the day, when the light is good enough, you're going to have a good picture. If you tap the IR button, switch to thermal mode, and you can see I'm able to zoom in by tapping the plus and the negative button that side as well. You can zoom up all the way up to 16 times. Very useful function, especially if you're 100 meters up in the air. If you want to switch to video mode, you can tap on the little slider on the right side of your screen. You can see the shutter button changes red, showing you that you are currently in video mode. You can also tap on the split button on the left side of the screen, or the visor button, to switch between infrared, visible, and actually both views at the same time. So completely up to you, but if you are flying at night, then I recommend the thermal view. If you're flying during the daytime, I recommend using the visible mode. Very useful feature though is to have both of them at the same time. As you can see, here I'm taking off, showing you the difference between the two views. You can see a lot more on the left side because the thermal view, you can even see the clouds in the background. So a very, very big difference indeed. Just some other very useful information. On the bottom left, you got your map. Tapping on your map is going to show you a big map view of where you currently are. Then you can also see in the middle of your screen at the bottom your actual GPS location with the coordinates, your altitude as well as the distance from your takeoff point, and your vertical speed as well as your horizontal speed. Now tapping on the top right, the little palette icon, it's going to bring up the different available options on your screen, what you can switch to change the thermal view. As you can see, iron red gives you a nice classic thermal view. Tapping the IR button on the bottom left shows you the complete screen in the infrared mode again. And as I gain altitude here, you're going to start seeing the difference in the screen as it widens up. Now, as you can see, the temperature keeps changing in the middle of the screen. That is the actual temperature that the sensor is reading. And if you tap the palette icon again, you can start switching between all of the different modes available. As you can see, there are quite a number of different options available, and each one of them is going to give you a different view or perspective of the temperature or the landscape in front of you. I personally like black hot and white hot the most, but if you start going through the different color palette options, you're going to see that each of them is going to have a place, as they will provide different information according to whoever is using the drone's needs. Like I said, my personal favorite is the white light option, so I'll switch back to that one and I'll gain some altitude, I think to around about 30 meters, just to take a view of what is going on the screen, so you can view and see a bit more what's going on while people are walking around on the screen. Now, just for some extra useful information, if you don't know this already, like I said, if you are used to the Go4 app, the screen and the menu items would look very familiar. But if you look at the top left, you can see it says in-flight GPS. If it's green, it's good to fly, you've got a GPS lock. If it's yellow, there's some kind of warning. Typically, you don't have GPS or you're in a high wind value area. In the middle of your screen, you can see which mode you're currently in. In this case, I'm in PGPS, which means I'm in position mode. If I flip to sport mode, it would say SGPS. On the right side of that, you're going to see this little plane and a little obstacle avoidance icon over there. That's ADBS. If there are planes flying around and they've got the sensor, then the drone would be able to detect the plane or the helicopter in the sky. Right next to that, you're going to see the little satellite icon, and above the little signal bar icon is going to show you the number of actively connected satellites that you're connected to. Right next to that, you're going to see the obstacle avoidance, two green icons available, top and bottom, and two little red dots on the left and the right. That tells you the obstacle avoidance is currently enabled for front and the rear, but not on the sides. Next to that, you get to see the controller icon, signal strength, which is going to essentially be your range, and the HD signal. They are typically running in hand, but if you lose controller signal, the drone is going to initiate return to home. Next to that, you're going to see the battery icon and your percentage. You can tap on that and it's going to take you straight to the battery settings in the app, where you can view the voltage and the flight time and so forth. Well guys, that brings us to the end of the video. If there's anything that I didn't cover or is unclear, please leave a comment below. And if you found this video useful or you liked it anyway, please remember to press the subscribe button and the bell notification. It really helps out the channel.